From Screen Junkie Studios in the heart of Los Angeles, this is Screen Junkie's Movie Fight. Now your host, Andy Signor.
Andy Signor is not here. Nick Mundy is here because Andy and Dan are dead or something. I don't know.
No, guys, they're in Chicago.
They're in Chicago. Great. Guys, welcome to Mundy Fights. And here's something fun. We're gonna have some fun today.
We're gonna have
a lot of fun. It's like school's out for summer.
The inmates are running the asylum.
So we got signs, we get stuff. It's gonna be a little silly. And so we're gonna have a lot of good fights today, including how to fix Fantastic Four, that heap of garbage. We are gonna talk about the best movie future ever. And because we're living in 2015 and life as we know is terrible. Right, so and best Disney princess, which I think is gonna be real fitting for a group of four guys in their 30s and 40s. They're just big bunch of white guys. So let's get going. Also, guys, if you don't like the topic we're talking about, you can click on the bottom right and pick your fight. But I don't recommend it because then you won't get the whole nuanced show, and each layer is builds upon a full. Don't just watch the whole thing. Watch the whole thing.
Or pick your nose and pick your fight.
Yeah.
Watch the whole thing.
And then also, you can listen to the show on iTunes when you're driving your auto cars from traffic. And, you know, we have an RSS feed, and you can subscribe, rate, and review. Give it the old thumbs. So, guys, let's get to it. Let's introduce our fighters, my friends. First up, we got the host of the Schmozno, the Suge Knight of the Schmozno. Oh. Christian Harloff.
I guess I shot Mark Ellis on the way over here. Nice to see you guys. Mance Man, our second round.
Isn't it true you dangled Josh McCuga out the window like Vanilla Ice?
We don't like to talk about that.
Yeah, no, but look, I'm just saying, he got stuff done. You get stuff done.
Yeah.
I mean, I think it's an apt description. Also, you're almost like, what, 3,000 away from... 3,000 subscribers away from
200,000. Yeah. So, by the way, and there's been so many of you guys from Movie Fights that from Mark and our appearances that have joined. So thank you, first of all, to Screen Junkies and for Movie Fights, because we've been building because of you guys. So thank you so much. And for you guys, hopefully we like the fight here. You guys go and you subscribe to Schmozno.
Subscribe. It's a good find. They're doing the Schmo Battle.
Great movie reviews.
I got the crap kicked out of me.
Oh, the Schmodown was fun.
Sorry about that.
I got the crap kicked out of me, too, because I bet wrong.
Yeah. Okay, speaking of betting wrong, we got Scott Mance here, guys, the Access Hollywood host, or Access Hollywood film critic.
Yes, sir.
Also, Hal Rudnick's Loop.
Yes,
this is your future.
Doppelgangers. Yeah. I mean, to have us in the same room, Hal.
If you touch, Time Cop rules, you can't occupy the same space.
It's unbelievable. Yeah. Crossing the stream.
So, and then to my left, he's a 6 to my 9, my mentor. My good boy, Hal Rudnick, the host of Screen Junkies.
I'm gonna cry.
Sweet.
Yeah, God. This is a lot of fun. And some of you guys are asking, hey, Mundy, why are you in the middle of everyone?
Why are you in the middle?
Yeah, well, I don't like to sit on the ivory tower and judge. I like to be in the fray, embedded. You know, I want to be in it with you guys.
Be in it.
Also, I want to win.
Are
you competing?
Are you competing against yourself?
How does the judge compete?
Yeah.
Because it's your show.
Right. So basically, we don't give the answers he wants. He's going to say, no, I'm going to answer, and then you win the show.
We've already gone off the rails. Yes.
No, I think we're doing pretty good.
Passing time
here. Hey, guys, I think we're doing pretty good. The fact that Jason's not crying is a really good sign. Speaking of Jason crying.
Jason
on Dan Cam, and then we don't have to talk much about him. To his left is my wife, Delara Mundy. She's the Jenny to my Forrest.
And the main reason she's here
is we're going to Costco, and we just wanted to make an efficient day. So
can we keep ourselves up on stuff?
Are we sponsored by Costco yet?
No.
Okay,
we'll be after the show.
Still good.
Nick's lovely wife. I was in attendance at your wedding. Is married she? By The Rock.
Everyone, look at the picture. It's kind of fun. And then also, guys, if you want some T-shirts, which none of us are wearing except for Jason. Go to District Lines. We got tons of Screen Junkie shirts, Movie Fight shirts, Honest Trailer shirts. We don't have a Monday Fight or Fight Monday Fight shirt, but we'll get on it. Jason, get on the shirt.
Also,
give me a shirt.
A Hal Rudnick bye-bye shirt.
Yeah, number one. We got some Hal Rudnick. So buy it. And then, guys, remember, we're keeping score based on creativity, on passion, on facts-ish, because you're a big liar.
Yeah,
you're a convicted liar.
Where's my poster?
I ripped it out. I'm good with the facts.
Yeah, too many. Yeah. So be cool. And also, I'm going to be completely biased. And, you know, I would recommend kissing my ass the entire time. So, guys, Let's fight. Like, let's play that montage. Play my montage.
This is where we fight.
Fight!
Fight!
Fight! Fight!
Ramwood. I beat it. I beat it. So here's the thing. As you guys know, or may not know, one of the things I got started doing Screen Junkies was fixing movies. I fixed a couple of movies. And everyone's been asking me, hey, fix Fantastic Four. But then that means I would have to see it. And I'm not going to see it.
Don't see it.
Because I'm a man, and I don't want to see garbage anymore. So I thought it would be like, I'm lazy. I want you guys to fix Fantastic Four for me. So William Roney at W. Roney of Dibs. That's a terrible Twitter name. Okay. I want you guys to pitch me a good Fantastic Four movie. Up first is Christian.
All right, Nick, I was thinking about this as far as you and I have had these conversations as eventually the Marvel Cinematic Universe will get the Fantastic Four back, and they should if they're going to incorporate it for to anyone to care. But as of right now, Fox is going to keep making these movies until they lose the rights. So just go balls to the wall. You've lost it at this point. Make them all villains. Make them all go a crazy, go a Deadpool crazy version with them. I want to see Sue Storm robbing banks as an invisible lady, and she never turns. There's no arc. She's just a bad person the whole entire time. Then you get Stretch is running around, and they call him Stretch. And he's running around. He's stealing wallets from around the block. And then you got Storm is setting things on fire just because he can. And finally, the Thing is a football player. That's my movie.
Is he covered in orange?
Yeah.
Or is he just JJ Watt?
He's the entire team.
He's in orange. He plays for the Broncos.
Who's the cast? Who's the cast of this calamity? I like where you're going.
Okay. I think that as far as it's a tough. Can I come back on the cast when I'm arguing?
Yeah.
All right.
I want to hear a pitch too. Mance.
Okay.
Top it. Good luck.
Fantastic Four is the crown jewel of the Marvel Universe. It was the first true Marvel comic back in 1961. And there goes Jason checking that fact.
Thanks, Raymond.
But here is exactly where Fantastic Four needs to right the past wrongs. You know, they tried in 2005 and 2007. Those movies were bad. They tried this year. This movie was the worst. They need to up the stakes, and they need to have a much better cast. They need to knock it out of the park. This is how you do that. You set it in the not-too-distant future. The Fantastic Four are a little older, and after a huge universal catastrophe brought on by Galactus, where the Fantastic Four were supposed to save the day, Reed Richards messed up and the U.S. military came in to save the day. After being shamed and defeated, the Fantastic Four were told to break up and disband. They all went their separate ways and took regular jobs, and they were miserable. But then the Brotherhood of Evil Mutants, led by Magneto, defeated the X-Men. So this is where we finally have that great Fox Marvel movie crossover, Fantastic Four versus the X-Men, and because both of these movies are distributed by Fox, and it's not going to go back to Marvel anytime soon. So this is where you really knock it out of the park. Have all the cast together, and then the Fantastic Four.
Which cast? Which which X-Men cast?
The ones not the first class. The you know, Wolverine, Hugh Jackman, okay. Those guys, Patrick Stewart, those guys, okay. The ones who were there from day one back in 2000,
okay.
July of 2000 to be exact. But this is where it gets really good. The Fantastic Four come back to save the day, and through the process, realize how much they missed each other, how much they need each other as family. And my cast, should I say now?
Yes,
or should I wait?
No, yeah.
Okay, the cast, you got to go big. You got to have a cast that's not second rate, that's not C-list. So I see Reed Richards, because they're older. Reed Richards is George Clooney. Sue Storm is Kate Blanchett. The Human Torch, Johnny Storm, is Samuel L. Jackson. Now, just imagine, in the climax, when Sam Jackson as the Human Torch comes back and he says, "Flame on, mother effer." Who doesn't want to see Samuel L. Jackson say that? And then finally, for the Thing. What is the Thing? The Thing is a big rock. So why not have The Rock, Dwayne Johnson, play The Thing? It's perfect casting. There you go.
All right. I like how you included The Rock.
Because but you wouldn't see The Rock because he's just The Thing.
Bring it out.
Here we go.
So you guys, Christian's is crazy. Scott's... is that sounds like three movies, what you described. The problem with the movie that just came out, The Fantastic Four, is it was poorly made. The cast was great. Miles Teller and Michael B. Jordan are wunderkinds.
Wunderkinds, that's wonderful.
So let's keep the cast the same. Give the movie to Marvel. Allow them to make a true-to-the-comics origin story with them turning from cosmic rays. And while they're out there, they meet up with Galactus. Galactus, who has fought with and in the Infinity War, has been involved in Thanos storylines before. Wow. You include that in the Marvel Universe? That is exciting. How many missteps has Fox had? Way too many. Let's give it back to Marvel already. How many missteps does Marvel have? The worst of Marvel isn't even close to the stinkers that Fox has cranked out.
So same cast?
Same cast. They were not given a chance. If you saw this movie, and I'm glad you didn't because it's hurtful.
It's Hero. Bad.
Hero.
It was poorly directed. They weren't given, it wasn't a fun movie. They weren't given any joy. They weren't directed to have any chemistry.
But you want to do another origin story?
Yeah.
With the same cast?
Yes.
No. Well, the problem is that I actually love Hal's version. I love it. The problem is Marvel's not getting it back anytime soon because Fox won't allow it. You're going to see a Fox version. You're just going to keep seeing it because they don't want to lose the rights. They won't. So that's why I'm saying I don't want it to continue to get tainted. If you're going to
do another, that's what people said about Spider-Man.
Well, yeah. Well, no, different studio. But it's a different studio, Sony. And the problem because what Sony had such an internal mess, mm-hmm. that Fox they're able to with Deadpool's going to be a success and X-Men's going to be a success. So the reason I'm going so ridiculous and extreme is because if you're going to, I don't want them to destroy the characters anymore. So let's get a version where it's almost like Deadpool, and you don't necessarily have to make the thing a football player. It's being ridiculous, but...
You said you don't want to destroy the characters, but let's destroy the characters.
If you're going to do it in Fox. If you can do it in Fox, because Marvel can get... Because that way, if you do such a ridiculous version, if it's fun, then everyone's talking about it. If it's horrible, it goes back to Marvel. But the thing is, as far as Scott's version goes... You lost me.
Why?
Because I don't care anymore. Because what Fox has done, you're trying to, like. And George Clooney, did you see Batman and Robin?
That was 1997. Get over it. Ever since that movie, he's made one great choice after another.
With your version, it's like, okay, let's cast Steve Buscemi as Mr. Fantastic.
Done.
Zach Galifianakis as the Thing.
You're pitching my movie for me.
No, it's just ridiculous.
The 22 Jump Street. Yeah, because the when Fantastic Four was created in what was it, 62 or something?
1961.
Everyone was on acid.
Yeah,
it was 1961.
It was almost the same. Look at what happened with Superman. As where Superman, for a very long time, was hard to get past that vision of him because it's the Boy Scout. We've changed as a society. It doesn't work as much anymore. And then when they changed him over Man of Steel, regardless of what you think of the movie, it worked.
It's not good.
But regardless, financially and for a lot of people, it worked because they changed the tone of it. And they had to because the Boy Scout wasn't working. Same thing with Fantastic Four. You've got to change it because it's the astronauts, the way it was back in the day, as far as our first mission to
Melissa McCarthy as Invisible Woman.
So you want to make just real quick. You want to make the meta Jump Street version of Fantastic Four?
Yeah, if we have to do it, let's do it.
Okay, I would see Christian's version of the Fantastic Four if it was a comic book version of What If. That's as far as that story goes. Hal, no one is going to embrace the cast of the movie we just had after that colossal misfire. You have to recast this movie. It was a colossal failure. You know,
they don't
worse.
Even
it wasn't
far
their fault.
Worse.
Yeah, but they don't
far
even want to
worse.
Do it.
But the point is that people will not embrace them because the movie was so bad. My version, what you have on the outside from the studio standpoint, you're going to have the X-Men series, which has been stellar, save the Fantastic Four series. And internally in the movie itself, the Fantastic Four characters will return the favor. This is a chance to go really big with the Fantastic Four by bringing the crossover that they've been talking about for a while, making it successful. And you have the movie directed by Bryan Singer, who knows how to infuse a family dynamic into X-Men. He can bring that sensibility to Fantastic Four. And again, The Rock is the Thing. You're all set.
Okay, wrap up. That was your wrap up. You did your wrap up. Okay, Hal.
Okay, so yours is a crash and burn. It's just a ridiculous idea.
Yes.
That would be a bastardization. And there'd be too many people would be like, what the hell are you doing?
Agreed.
And they revolt. Yours, you basically described like three movies. So they lose to Galactus, which is or they fight Galactus, which is my movie, so thank you for getting on board with my idea. And then they go their separate ways, like in when Superman loses his powers or whatever. And then they reform. That's so much. That couldn't be done in a single part. Mine, let's see the Fantastic Four done right. We haven't gotten that yet. And how many times do we reboot Spider-Man? Do we reboot Batman? Let's see this again. But there was a contingent that wanted Andrew Garfield to go to Marvel. That didn't happen. But why not these fine actors? This is an excellent cast that was poorly directed. Josh Trank just drove the crashed a plane into the tarmac.
Trank's tanked.
Yeah, Trank tanked.
Okay, I got it. That's a nice bell.
That was
that's a
nice
bell.
That's
a good. Yeah, that was
a strong
cool.
bell. Okay. Shame. Here's the thing. You pitched. They're right. They knocked you out, buddy. They pitched three movies. Also, like, the cast is good, but like that was the strongest part. It's between you two, honestly. And what he got you, unfortunately, was like the Marvel. Like, the Marvel's never going to get these characters. And that's the hard thing to get over. Also, I didn't like the doing the origin story with the cast, and I'm not into that cast. So Christian won first point.
Wow,
probably the only point he'll get.
Probably.
Thank you, buddy. Probably. I'm not keeping score well, so you got to keep score. You got to keep score.
We got a thing. Yeah, it's 1 point for Christian.
Okay,
it's pretty,
well.
Pretty simple.
Shmo down this final.
And Christian was really worried I was gonna take it out on him, just because of life. And I didn't, so you got it. So I went, don't get braggy. And let's hit up to round two. All right. Round two. We're in the future, as I said. It's 2015. This is the year Back to the Future 2 was supposed to take place. Right. They're liars. Like, they were liars. This future sucks. We're all dying. Okay, but let's imagine a future, that was good. Movies taught us something. I'm going to bring this up. Time Cop 2004. Time Cop was awesome. Let's talk about some futures. What is the coolest movie future? Stuart Johnson at St. Johnson 82. Now we know how old he is. Asked this question. What is the coolest movie future? And for clarification, we're not talking about the best movie. We're just talking about the future that lives in. But don't pull some bullshit. Don't pick like a Elysium. Because I'll just disqualify that. Pick like a real.
All right, let's do it.
Yeah, all right, but hold on. No, I'm running this. Now Scott goes first.
Okay.
Coors Light.
You sponsored by Coors Light yet?
By the way, it's 10 a.m. 10
a.m.
It's a Sunday. Scott, you're up first.
Okay. Well, if there's any movie future I want to live in, it is the future of Star Trek. You got 12 movies. These last two films that J.J. Abrams directed depicted a positive, idealistic, utopian depiction of the future. You look at any other great sci-fi movie that has a depiction of the future. My favorite movie of all time is Blade Runner. I love Minority Report. But while they are cool films, they are not futures I would want to live in. I would want to live in a future in the 23rd century where humanity has gotten past many, but not all, but many of their petty differences, where they are exploring strange new worlds on vast starships that have explored 20% of the galaxy, where they are transporting all over the place, and you never have to wait in rush hour traffic ever again. Star Trek was always about
there was
something.
There's traffic all over the garbage fight between Spock and White Khan in the last Star Trek. Okay, but keep going.
Okay. But generally, this is a future that is positive. It's our future. It shows that whereas most sci-fi films of the future sort of are allegories and warnings and cautionary tales, if we are not careful, this shows our positive side. Star Trek 2009 came out the year after the Great Recession. And where most films were so dark, this was one that was positive. It gives people hope. Their future, the future of Starfleet in the 23rd century, is full of hope. It is optimistic versus pessimistic. That's a future I want to live in, and I want to live there now.
I thought that was really good because I usually just think of Star Trek as a bunch of virgins and Under Armour.
Wow.
So but that really elevated my thought.
Here we go.
No, I'm saying you did a really good job.
I'm saying you did really, but that's what I usually think of Star Trek. So, Hal, you're up next.
See, I'm picking a positive future, but a real positive future that is futuristic, okay? Star Trek, when you're on Earth, it's not that, it wasn't that futuristic. You still have a guy riding the motorcycle in the cornfield and just like it. A real positive future, a utopian future with a dash of awesomeness, Demolition Man. Okay? Oh, yeah. There. You want no crime? You want peace? The future of Demolition Man, there's no crime unless you unfreeze a cryogenic criminal, and then you cryogenically unfreeze a super cop to stop him. It's that easy. The future is, they figured it out. And then we left Demolition Man with Spartan.
John Spartan.
John Spartan. Stallone's cop about to really jazz things up. He was about to let's throw some spice into this. So you already have a peaceful future, and you have Stallone saying like, "Oh yeah, let's make it that much better," taking it by the horns. Schwarzenegger was the president, so they got a sense of humor in the future. There's a Taco Bell everywhere. What's the you know what I waste most of my time doing? Deciding where to eat. No more.
That's a good point. Right,
this is my favorite round so far.
Okay. I love that future. I love it. The only problem is you can't have sex. You got to rub together seashells, so that's out for me.
No, that's how you shit.
No, it's also there's like a seashells or something. There's something you have to listen. There was a whole reason why Sandra Bullock
is
like
VR.
There's some kind of he couldn't really do it.
Spartan's going to change that.
Yeah, well, he didn't. But as far as for me. Now, I know I'm going to get the looks. The Matrix. Because if you're one of those morons that took the pill to get out of there, then that's on you. But everybody else, if you wanted to, you're eating real steak as far as you're concerned. If you want to be, guess what? You got plugged into the right person. You're a movie star. You're Channing Tatum for all you know. You don't know. It could be some schmuck living who thought, you know, was maybe down in his luck, got plugged into the Matrix, and he's a movie star now. So there's so many different ways that the Matrix can change. And if you figure it out, you might be able to fly in the Matrix. So to me, the future of being inside of that computer world, if you figure out and learn how to use it, is the best future because we all know.
Yeah. If the Matrix is the Matrix, aren't we in the Matrix right now?
Yeah, we just have to figure out how to fly. Eventually.
That's not the future.
What? Not necessarily.
That's not the future. That's the future. Right now.
It's also make-believe.
Not necessarily.
It's not reality.
Well, not necessarily. Not necessarily because it is reality because they've come up with enough technology. It does take place in the future. You're hooked in. You could be hooked into... Now, you can be hooked into 1985. You can be hooked into 2003.
But
if
you're hooked in,
it's a computer program.
If you're hooked in, you are not living in reality. The problem with Demolition Man, while Demolition Man does take place in a positive future, humanity has gotten so damn lazy and so stupid. And I'm with you on the sex thing, jeez.
Yeah.
But they've gotten so lazy that they have to thaw out a man from the 20th century to save their world.
And
I mean,
guess what?
Wait, you just made
the argument.
One guy with a good cameo.
They can't. They're not smart enough to do it themselves. In the universe, in the world, in the future of Star Trek, they can figure themselves out. They can figure things out on their own. They can solve problems on their own. They can grow as humanity on their own. They don't need to be plugged into a fake reality.
Let me ask you this.
They don't need to be plugged in. They don't need to live in this future where they can plug into anything. They're living in the moment. It's real. It is not fake.
But it's exclusive.
Like the Matrix
is. Exclusive, though. Like only a few people are allowed to go into space. And like Hal said, it's boring. They all walk around in these coats, and they don't know how to defend themselves because Benedict Cumberbatch just comes in and goes, "Yeah, I'm going to blow everything up," and then you're screwed. They go in panic like ants.
If you live in a safe utopian future, why is every Star Trek movie the world, the universe, the galaxy is in peril from Klingons?
I'll tell you why.
From Benedict Cumberbatch.
I'll tell you why. Because it is the Federation, 23rd century and the 24th, if you include the Next Generation, they're about peace. They're about exploration. They only resort
in my
to
future.
War.
There are no they Romulans that are going
to
come and smoke
to
your
war
ass
when they have to defend themselves, and that is what they've been doing a lot in the Star Trek.
In
movies.
Our future,
but the future is still positive. It is still idealistic.
Your future has a lot of pussies in it, though. Like they're really weak.
But what he said. John Spartan is jazzing. We
one
left,
guy, though.
But
what happens when he dies? He's screwed again.
We left, and oh, but he is turning the tide. And you know who we could cryogenically thaw out?
Everyone's gonna be shitting their pants with Taco Bell.
We could cryogenically thaw out a Kiss concert for you, Nick Mundy, and we could cryogenically thaw out every All Star Houston Astro of all time, and have the Houston Astros.
I just lost. Okay. I want to hear final thoughts. No, you're not. You're out because we don't even know what future they're in.
True.
Yeah. Okay. Amen. You know that.
I can see.
Yeah. I might need your help on this one because this is good. Because here's the problem: Star Trek and Demolition Man have like three badasses and the rest virgins. We got it. Like, okay, tell me the difference. What? Why would you tell me why I want to live in your universe? And then we'll go.
First of all, Captain Kirk is a hero in every sense of the word. When he was an admiral in Star Trek's one and two, and then he got demoted.
And then he got demoted. Yeah.
Okay, but he is a man of action. He's a man of passion.
Why would I want to live in Star Trek?
But these are to say that there's any virgins in the 23rd century is an ignorant assumption.
I'm really dumb.
They have sex with aliens.
And to assume that like all the people on Earth don't get to go. Just you saw people on the Earth because it has to be populated, but anyone could go into space. Anyone can be in Starfleet. It is open to anyone regardless of their race, color, or creed. I mean, that it has broken down all racial prejudicial barriers whatsoever. This is something we aspire to right now as human beings, and we can get there even before the 23rd century. But if it takes that long, I want to be cryogenically frozen.
That's a pipe dream, okay? We are very close. Let's attain it. We are very close. They're using tablets. They have self-driving cars.
Look at
we
cell are phones almost and communicators.
There. We are almost there.
People Let's Skype keep going. On Star Trek.
We don't even know that tacos exist in your future.
Okay, done.
Oh boy. There we go.
I like Star Trek. You got me into Star Trek. I'm not into Star Trek. Like I want to watch Star Trek now cuz that's a good thing. We peace and unity and stuff. House of tacos. They have tacos.
Mundy fights.
How one.
I love this episode.
As a point of fact checking, I just want to point out that in the world of Star Trek, there are replicators that can make multiple tacos. So Scott, if you had said that, you would have won.
Yeah.
That's your fault.
Why can't I get these between the Schmodown and movie fights? I just can't do it.
I got the shit kicked out of me on Schmodown too, so we're good. I'm selling your pen because I lost your pen. Okay, that was round two. That was good. That was really good.
Where's Andy? Is Andy coming back? Star Trek 1982, nothing?
I don't think we're doing great. Okay, this is round three. Guys, okay, here's the thing. We all like comic book movies, right? We do. There's like 21 or 22 coming out in the next 5 years. Yeah. And that's, I don't know about you, that's too many. Ooh. I feel like that's too many. Do you guys agree?
Yeah.
Okay. And we all like comic. I mean, this is how, you know, we get that money. We get that paper.
I can prove it. I am wearing a comic book t-shirt as a 46-year-old.
Yeah, but... So here's my question. Which comic book movie being released between now and 2020, which is crazy, that's just weird, but would you get rid of and why? It could be multiple too. So I'm going with Hal, you're up first.
Okay.
Get a sweet baby.
Yeah, man. I would dump Gambit, okay? I would dump Gambit because Fox has shown us what they've done with standalone X-Men movies, and they are either dull or garbage with the Wolverine movies. Also, in the you know what the standalone X-Men movies have given us? They've given us Will.i.am. They've ruined Deadpool, and they've just been bad. We have X-Men movies. Let's put him in an X-Men movie. Why don't you make him a key character in an X-Men movie first before you give us a solo Gambit movie. Also, we just don't need that. He's an awesome character, but they have a bad track record. We just don't need it.
All right. Christian.
I, going off of what Hal said as far as a key character that needs to be set up in a, that's not a key character that needs to be set up in a movie first, I'm going to go with Cyborg. Because Cyborg, for me right now, is... We have so many movies in the DC universe that need to be set up first. You need to have your core Batman, Superman, the Batman standalones, more Man of Steel. Green Lantern needs to be resurrected. It needs to come back from the last disaster. It needs some kind of version of it. Because Cyborg, to me, he's essentially what Hawkeye is for the Avengers. He's that character that you want to see, and he's going to be a strong character too. But there are too many movies right now that need standalones before. I mean, before Cyborg gets a movie, I want to see. I really want to see Shazam because of what Black Adam and Shazam. That's another version of Superman, and what Black Adam already to have set up with The Rock. That's a character I want to see. That's a character that can have a lot of impact in that universe. As where Cyborg, let's set him. Like Hal was saying about Gambit, let's set up Cyborg first. I know him the least out of the characters, and there's a reason for that. I'm not saying he's not going to be a character that has a lot of impact. As of right now, he doesn't need a standalone.
Okay. Okay. Scott, bring it.
Funny you should mention this Super Shazam there, buddy, because Shazam is one movie that if that disappeared from the schedule, I would not miss it one bit. And you said it because it is just another version of Superman. We don't need another version of Superman. Let's get the one we have right now. Right, Man of Steel. I was not a fan of Man of Steel. It is not just because I have an affinity for the Richard Donner version. It is not because it is idealistic. It is, or the Donner version was too idealistic. Get Superman right. We don't need Shazam. Shazam is kind of like a wuss version of Superman. And I just don't think the character is necessary. I think it's always been sort of like Superman's too close to Superman. You know, with all these other Superman movies coming out, you got sequels to Avengers and X-Men and Spider-Man and Batman and Superman, all the stuff. Just get Superman right. Don't worry about Shazam.
Okay, so you just committed a major offense. You know who's playing Black Adam in Shazam? The Rock. You are trying to take The Rock out of DC Marvel superhero possibility.
But I tried to put him into the Marvel universe with Fantastic Four as the thing. Nick, so give me that.
The Rock is passionate about this movie. He's been lobbying for it. He wants
you're spinning yarns about the Fantastic Four. Yeah. Meanwhile, you want to take away the real.
My version of Fantastic Four was awesome. You guys are out of your
head. Let me tell you also why we would want to see Shazam. He's a golden age character. We don't have any cool old time golden age superhero stories besides the first.
Superman,
besides the first,
it also gives a role.
No, Superman doesn't take place there. Captain America was the only like kind of golden age feeling. The first Captain America. That Shazam could be really cool.
And it also gives
in that
a good
respect.
Role to a kid that would be able to transfer over to what Shazam is. And
yeah.
I think that you can. There are a lot of great kid and actors right
here's,
now.
Here's why we need Cyborg. We can't.
In a standalone?
We can't pull the plug on.
Pun.
We can't pull the plug on a superhero that's a black superhero.
Well, that's what The Rock.
We need
the Rock
a black superhero.
That's why I mentioned Shazam, because The Rock is. It's a black superhero and a powerful one at that. And
yeah,
Shazam
The Rock is playing
that's
black
Adam. Superman. Well, yeah, that's true.
Playing
he's
the
black
villain.
Adam, but he's the villain. Yeah.
Yes, a black superhero. We need that. We have Black Panther in the Marvel Universe. DC doesn't have one.
Right.
You don't want to pull the plug on that.
That's why I think they're going to go with John Stewart for Green Lantern. That's going to be your black superhero. And one has a better
name.
Cyborg
has a lot of really modern possibilities because he's like half computer. And you can get into the NSA and all sorts of spying and that kind of stuff. Like, will he use his powers for good or evil?
Christian, break down.
Well, I just want to say as far as X-Men goes, like, because Hallett brought up as far as how Fox has screwed up a lot of the characters. And even with X-Men, you got to remember that Laura Shuler-Donner, thank you, has been trying for a Gambit movie for a very long time. And the Fox regime at the time was that with the people that were ahead of Fox, those are the ones who really screwed up that X-Men Origins, and they bullied that director as where they're not going to do that this time around with Gambit. They've really been working on it, and it fits into the X-Men universe of what they've done well. I know you weren't a fan of Days of Future Past, but But as far as this cinematic universe, what they're doing with X-Men, they're in line now.
I'm not putting that as a
so
thing.
By
yeah.
throwing
no.
Gambit
they're
in
trying
there,
this time.
Yeah, yeah, so by throwing Gambit and who's one of the biggest movie stars out there right now.
Real quick, Jason, do any of these movies have directors attached?
That I
get on it, Jason.
Yeah.
get on.
Hey, while he's doing that, I just want to say first of all. Yeah, Fox has definitely screwed up some of its characters. Obviously, Fantastic Four being a prime example. Daredevil 2003 was a misfire. But the X-Men films have been stellar. The third one, X-Men, The Last Stand, is my least favorite of the X-Men movies, but it's still not that bad. The movie that I really, really loved, the standalone Fox superhero movie is The Wolverine from 2013, directed by James Mangold. This was a standalone film. It was different from other superhero movies because it didn't feel like a superhero movie. It felt like a samurai movie, and it was very, very
character-driven.
Yep. It was a great film. I think it's an underrated, underseen movie, and underappreciated film. But again, Shazam, The Rock, Dwayne Johnson, he is not playing the hero. He's playing the villain. I just don't think that
Shazam is
enough of a strong character, depending, regardless of where it takes place, where it stands apart from Superman.
Well, I think we have a chance, though, to let Joe Manganiello, who was actually rumored to play Superman for a long time, play Shazam and go against Black Adam. I agree with you. You don't want to take away an African-American superhero. You don't. But that's why I think Jon Stewart needs to be the Green Lantern. Like I said before, the Green Lantern is a property that was almost ruined. And by putting
I won't get too much into it.
There are going to be many Lanterns. There are going to be many.
But he's
got to
be the first guy. A guy like that, Jon Stewart leading the Green Lanterns. You talk about it, and that's a strong black superhero. We're kind of all over the place.
Jason, do you have that information? Jason?
I just want to point out that we are having Wi-Fi problems right now, so my fact-checking is going to be a little bit slower than usual, but there are no directors attached to any of these movies.
Okay, good job, Jason.
Good job.
Good sweet boy. Jason, sweet boy. okay. I don't want to hear about your other movies because you guys have told me this. Why would your movie suck the most?
Because Fox has crapped the bed so many times. Fantastic Four just happened. Wolverine Origins. So you want to give us a Gambit movie? Include him in the X-Men and stop trying to be a hero, okay?
Days of Future Past and Deadpool right there alone to go against that point. But as far as my movie, Cyborg sucks. Cyborg sucks because it's not that it's going to suck. It's the fact that you don't need him. He's Hawkeye. He's going to help the Justice League. He's going to be a big part of Justice League. We don't need a standalone film for him just yet.
Scott? Man in a Cape. There's only one that really counts. It's Superman. Man of Steel underperformed. Well, didn't underperform. It just came under. It wasn't as good as it should have been. Let's get Superman right before we worry about another character that is just like Superman.
This is hard. Jason, what do you think?
I think you're the judge.
But everything's factual. I just want to get the facts right.
We're as factual as we can be.
Okay.
With this.
But you know a bunch of this nerd crap.
Yeah.
So, okay.
I wouldn't call it crap, but
yeah. Everything's crap. All right. Here's the thing. I'm going over this right now. You're right. Your Shazam versus Superman point is really good. I like that. So I'm coming back to that. I think he knocked you out. No one has announced Green Lantern. You do need, to me, like Cyborg's like, you need a strong African American lead, and that all the universes need that. You're right about you're right about Fox is pretty terrible at standalone movies, including the Wolverine. That was bad.
Oh, come on, it was good.
That was bad. Shh.
It's positive on Rotten Tomatoes.
No, it was like, yeah, you know what? Okay. Shazam. But you know what? Okay, Hal got the point. Here's the thing. Shazam is like the most interesting character there. He's in the, and then he knocked it out because like Gambit is just, they almost didn't make that movie. They almost didn't make that movie. Like, okay, what? I'm trying. This is hard. Scott.
Love for you, brother.
I know. Hal, kicking ass. Christian doing good. Christian's putting out the vibe.
What's the vibe?
What, Jason? What'd you say to my girl?
Who did you just get?
Hal won.
Thank you.
Hal got the point.
I was double-checking the score. Thank you.
Yeah. Ooh. It's 2-1-0, but Scott's going to come back.
Monday fights.
Yeah. All right. You guys having fun?
Could not be having more fun, Jason.
Hey, I could not be having more fun.
Next to my good friend Christian Harloff.
We're all best friends.
Nick Monday, my brother from another mother here. All right. Rutnick.
You guys, round four. And this is a question that I am absolutely perfect to judge for. Havado at Owen_CZ at Twitter asked, dudes, who is the best Disney princess? All right. Hal, will you look under that hat and hand me a beer? Thank you.
Well played.
Okay, so Christian,
you're
up first. Let's hear who is your best Disney princess.
I have a 2.5-year-old. She's almost 4 now. When she was 2.5, I showed her Cinderella.
Okay.
Cinderella to me, and now I know the arguments will probably be the fact that it's 1950s. It's kind of a dated movie, but she still is. When you see her, she's like
to quote Hal, iconic. She is one of those. She's just one of those princesses. As far as she should have the worst life, the worst perspective on life in the world. She's locked in a dungeon, and she's smiling. She's singing. She could go the crazy route. Yeah, she talks to mice. She's a bit nuts, but she embraces it. Those are her friends. She's able to dance and sing and have these rotten people, yet she still keeps a positive outlook the whole entire time. And because she does it, she has a positive outlook on it. Some old lady with a thing says, you know what? Here's a night. Have a great night. Go get hammered. Go meet the prince. She meets the prince. She puts
they
out
get
a slipper.
Hammered?
She gets hammered. You don't see it. It's a cut scene. But, okay. And then
I believe you. I've never seen it.
Yeah. And then she winds up going, meeting the prince, and then she lives in a castle because she held out and she didn't just mope the whole time. My life sucks. She never did that once. So a person who says, my life sucks and doesn't do anything about it, Cinderella is not that, and that's why she's the best.
Okay. All right. I didn't know they got drunk in Cinderella.
Is it behind the? It's hard to find. It's a cutscene.
Scott, my friend.
Okay. Well, here's the deal. Cinderella is iconic.
You could have just lied again. You're a liar.
That's a cutscene.
And guys, lying's not bad.
No.
Yeah. But we have a fact checker.
De Niro has a cameo in Cinderella.
You have the Jason, you're the man, buddy. Here's how I feel about this. Cinderella, yeah, she's an icon. She's been around a long time. But 1991, they gave us Beauty and the Beast. Belle from Beauty and the Beast. Her name means beauty. Right there alone. But what makes her special is that she looks past the Beast to embrace his inner beauty, regardless of his looks. That makes her the least vain of any Disney princess, and that makes her the best role model for any princess growing up, including yours, sir. But what makes Belle really special, more special than any other Disney princess, is that Beauty and the Beast was the first animated movie to ever be nominated for the big prize, Best Picture. It will always be the first movie to get nominated for Best Picture. Belle is the best Disney princess.
That's incredible. Jason, look up the movies that are... came out in 1992 that got Best Picture.
All right.
Or make them up if the Wi-Fi's not working.
Got it.
I think Little Man Tate was one. Was Little Man Tate?
Little Man Tate. It was 91.
Yeah, it was
91.
That's actually one.
Okay. All right, that was good. All right, Hal, break it.
With all due respect, gentlemen, I call bullcrap.
You want to take that?
The number one princess in Disney history is Mulan. Your princesses set women back decades. They are weak women in peril. Wow. And they all go by the same formula. They need a rich man to save them. Mulan kicks ass. She is allowed to be a hero. Unbelievable. It is none other than Mulan. She's the most progressive, and she's not a white woman in peril that needs a rich prince to save her.
Plus, you have a type.
Hal?
My girlfriend is Japanese.
Hal? Was Mulan nominated for Best Picture? No, it was not. Was it?
Or Little Man Tate.
I don't think you're talking about the movie. We're talking about the best Disney princess.
Right, but
it is Mulan.
It is about.
Well, the thing
is, your movie is so old fashioned that the song is Tale as Old as Time.
Wait, it's old fashioned, but it's old fashioned in the classic Disney sense, but it is also forward thinking because the beauty, Belle, chose the Beast over a good looking jerk.
It's because he got those dollars and she's a gold digger.
You ever see Beautiful Mind? Okay.
Oh,
and Russell Crowe went bananas sitting in a room by himself. Cinderella didn't do that. She could have. And he had Jennifer Connelly. She had mice, and she was able to.
She wasn't good at math either. So,
but she was able to. The thing that we're talking about princess in general, so we can also include the most recent Cinderella that just came out, and they have. She was a very strong character. She could have, her mother taught her that instead of looking at all the negative, to look at the positive. She didn't just rely on the prince. It was because she was able. But it was she was able to.
Let me ask you. Let me implore you.
Yes, sir.
I don't want to tell you how to parent.
Yes,
but I'm going to ask
that
you show your daughter Mulan. And teach her to be a strong, independent, kick-ass
woman. She became violent after she saw it. And I don't want my kid becoming violent.
Okay. Parent fights is awesome.
She started kicking things, and I don't want her to kick. I want her to be
Scott,
nice.
Yes, I don't want to tell you how to be a husband.
Mm-hmm. Tell me how to be a husband. I like to hear this.
But show your wife Mulan. And teach her how to be a strong,
don't be a beast.
My wife worked for Disney. Okay, she knows all these
Nick,
movies.
Yeah, buddy. Nick, can I make some points that might affect your decision?
Real quick, I'm not... Hal... She kicks ass, and I've been told violence and fighting are not the most important traits of humanity.
Why else is Mulan nice and good?
Because she's doing that to save her father. Wow. She's not trying to be a gold digger. She's not trying to be like, oh, someone come save me. No.
Belle's a gold digger.
Belle, you don't think Belle's a gold digger?
She takes the money when I'm in need.
Yeah. Belle is not a gold digger. Belle is anything but a
she
gold
digger. She takes the money.
She had her own mind. She had her own mind. She could have gone with the good-looking jerk, but she said no. I'm going to go with the guy who's got beauty in his heart.
Belle also had her pops to kind of talk her through this stuff. As again, my girl had a mop, and she was able to still persevere.
Yeah, mop is not realistic. Who talks to their mop?
Christian's argument is, hey, we should be happy that Christian did, like, she didn't become a serial killer.
Yes, absolutely. I think that's pretty good. Yeah, she could have become Dexter.
Hold on, Jason's going to speak words.
I have some quick cleanup and some thoughts. I was wrong, Wi-Fi problems. The Gambit director was actually Rupert Wyatt. That's the director. Mm. Also, in 1991, the Best Picture nominees were Beauty and the Beast, Silence of the Lambs, Prince of Tides, JFK, and Bugsy. And I just want to point out, we were talking about the best Disney princess. Maybe we want to ask the one princess in the room?
Hey, shut up, Jason.
Silence of the Lambs could have been Cinderella's story.
It could have been JFK.
Way.
JFK is that best movie of that. Delara, you're big on... I've maybe seen some of these movies. What do you think?
I have to go with Mulan.
Mulan. Okay.
Of any of the princesses that I would want to be like or have the same story, it would be Mulan.
Because she doesn't want to be painted into a corner by Disney's societal norms. A man is the hero and a woman is the damsel in distress.
Time, but it's also time. It's
different
time periods.
Okay. Here's the thing. And I'm not going to explain why because that just gives it away. I have an affinity for the beautiful girl who falls in love with the hairy, terrible beast. So I will. Scott, you're on the board.
Oh, thank God.
Thank God. And we fight. Okay, that's being in a relationship. We don't have to get along all the time.
I'll take 1 point. At least I'm not shut
Who's
out.
Who's Mrs. Potts in your story?
Me. Okay. I'm Miss.
Angela Lansbury's pretty great in Beauty
She's
and the
great.
Beast.
Yeah, come on, thank you.
I know you had the affinity for the fighting, but like I just wanted to know more about
Bell
this.
Strong
and
too. Bell strong.
That Christian, this is Thanks, your best man. Movie fight
yeah.
so far.
Thanks, man.
He's great.
Yeah,
Christian's the man.
Sometimes this is how you always movie fight.
Thank you.
This is how you always movie fight. Thank you. All you guys.
By the way, this is how Christian is when we're not movie fighting. This is
no,
he
yeah,
really
when
is.
He's a human being.
I mean, in a good way.
All right, guys, we forgot to do the pledge. I just realized we forgot to do the Pledge of Allegiance. Stop it!
Sorry.
All right, round five! Woo!
Woo! Round five!
Everyone's having fun!
Yes! Round five!
Click some likes and put some comments.
Boo, boo, boo! Boo, boo, boo!
I'm sure there's some people that hate this.
The most energetic round five's ever been.
Yeah, round five, excited!
Yeah.
All right.
Yes, excited for round
so,
five.
So, guys.
Yes.
I like buddy cop movies. I like buddy movies. Yeah. I also like talking about myself. So, round five. Dick Fundy on Twitter asks.
That's your Twitter handle, by the way.
Yes.
pitch a buddy movie starring Nick Mundy. Also, guys, you can't include The Rock. That's a challenge.
I used The Rock already in my Fantastic Four pitch, which I should have won.
Yeah, well, it didn't. Hal, if you could be a sweetie and grab me a beer under
Oh,
that
you
hat.
Got it.
Okay?
You got it,
and
lover.
Scott, you're going up.
Okay, here it is. Ready? The buddy movie that I love the most from the 80s mm-hmm. is Midnight Run.
Yeah.
Came out in 1988, directed by Martin Brest, starring Charles Grodin and Robert De Niro. Underseen movie. It wasn't a big hit when
you
it
You should
came
watch
out.
It. Dummies, watch it and start watching Guardians again.
It is. Midnight Run is a great movie. So I thought because it was little seen, even though it caught on as a cult comedy classic, why not remake it with Nick Mundy?
Like
and
it.
Instead of Midnight Run, it is Midnight Mundy. Your name, sir, is in the title.
Okay.
Now, the basic story is the same. Bounty hunter goes after this guy, and it's a cross-country trip. But here's where it's a little different. So Jonathan Mardukas, the Duke, is played by Nick Mundy. Mm-hmm. Nick Mundy, the Duke, Jonathan Mardukas, is the administrator of the world's biggest and most powerful social media website. It is bigger than Facebook. It is bigger than Twitter. It is also run by the mob. And once the Duke realizes this, he takes the information and he's going to go to the feds. So that's when the mob hires a bounty hunter to go after the Duke. The bounty hunter, played in the original film, is by Robert De Niro, Jack Walsh. In the remake, the bounty hunter is a woman, a strong, sexy woman who doesn't take crap from anyone. And this is Jacqueline Walsh, Jack Walsh, played by the one, the only rising star. She's going to be powerful, Margot Robbie. Then the story becomes very similar to the original. It is a road trip movie. It is a buddy movie. It is a bonding film where it does get romantic between Nick Mundy.
So you want a buddy movie where the buddies have sex?
That is exactly what I'm talking about.
Hey, Delara, what do you think of Scott's erotic fan fiction?
It's a movie.
It's creative.
It's creative. Okay. And I have to say, if you're going to have a buddy pick, why not put a woman in the film and make her a strong and sexy woman indeed.
So did you guys use all my old headshots for the pictures?
Pretty much.
Okay, yeah. All right, that's sexy.
Sexy. It's a sexy buddy movie.
Okay, how
with
break
Nick
it down.
Mundy.
Okay, my flick. I team a man, Nick Mundy, up with the best sidekick of all time, Sergeant Al Powell, Mr. Reginald Vell Johnson. You may also know him from your favorite show, Christian, Family Matters.
I do. I watched it right before
you
I got here.
You watched it?
Right before this, I got here. In my car, I almost crashed.
This buddy comedy is entitled Die Hard 6, Stop the Making of Die Hard 6. Real life Nick Mundy and real life Reginald Vell Johnson are on a mission, possibly a mother grabbing suicide mission, to stop the very evil and very tired Bruce Willis from further flushing the Die Hard franchise down the crapshoot.
There's so much dramatic tension already.
Oh, man. Imagine we are on a movie studio lot and Nick Mundy and Reginald Vell Johnson crashing through the gates in a 1960s Cadillac convertible. Bam! Oh, wow. It would be glorious. It would be effing glorious. And we're racing up to the martini shot, up to the last shot of the movie. Will they or won't they stop this thing? Wow.
Yeah, it's
Die Hard 6.
I'm in.
Stop the making of Die Hard 6.
That's yes.
That's a hell of a marquee.
Christian, let's bring it, man. You got tough competition, right?
This summer.
Ooh.
In a world where Nick Mundy is in a race against time to stop every movie he hates from being made. Not only Die Hard, Terminator, another one, most of Arnold Schwarzenegger's career, and his partner, Hal Rudnick, as well as future Hal Rudnick, played by Scott Mance.
Here we go.
You're going to have a lot of stuff happening in this movie, and they do crash through the wall in a 1960s convertible, although every single time that Nick Mundy shows up, it's Hal Rudnick going, guess who's here? Nick Mundy going to shut down Arnold Schwarzenegger? Mr. Governor, stop making movies?
Comment below. Does that sound like me?
iconic? Oh, my. I mean, and then you go into the future, and who's there waiting for Nick Mundy?
I'm 1991, Scott Mance. Here to tell Nick Mundy he's going to shut it down.
You have so much stuff. What Nick Mundy's going to do here, he is going to stop every movie he hates, and it doesn't matter. He's going to be like the Terminator of bad movies in his world. So if you like it, it doesn't matter, because even though you can't have The Rock saying being in the movie, you can have Nick saying it doesn't matter. He's going to stop every stupid thing that he hates in movies, and guess what it's going to be called? Quoting you, iconic, with Nick Mundy and Hal Rudnick running around. Hal Rudnick, you're going to be like Bill, you're going to be like Duke in Rocky, just pumping him up. Champ is here. Champ is
did
here every single time.
So wait, did you just reference Rocky V?
No, what, not Bill. I
movie?
Almost said, I said what's Bill Duke, but Duke
movie?
Duke is the, oh, okay, the one to talk. Okay. Yeah.
What's the movie?
I don't even know.
It doesn't matter. That's the whole point. Because it's Nick Mundy.
Why
shutting
would Nick
down.
Mundy want to be in a bad movie?
It's not a bad movie. It's your movie. You literally anything that you want to shut down. And the actual it's silly. It's comedy. It is again. We're going to quote like 21 Jump Street as where you get to be the guy. If you want to actually make robots with Blu-rays that look running around Blu-rays with feet and sneakers that look like stupid movie. You don't like X-Men: Days of Future Past. Fine. It can be a villain. Whatever you want it to be, Nick, that is your villains. I'm done. I don't care if I lost a round. That's the movie I want to see, mother effs.
You made me sound like a monster.
I love it.
What?
Okay.
What?
Scott, okay. I'm contemplating that. Tell me
no,
about...
I'm not contemplating that.
Look, I'm not outright dismissing it like other hosts.
Yeah.
I like the weirdness. So, but Scott, tell me about your. Well, it's not slash fiction, but you know.
It is an actual. This is an actual movie.
People that's fair.
Pay,
yeah.
People would pay to see Midnight Monday. This is a classic story. It is a road trip. It has comedy. It has action. It has heart. It has sex. This is a strong male and strong female role, and it is just a movie. So your wife, your beautiful blonde wife,
can I actually be the Margot
Robbie character in the sex scenes. And there you go, everybody's
You know
happy.
Who's playing your wife in my movie?
Oh, yeah,
your wife.
Thanks.
Okay.
No. Yeah.
Did you hear that? Did you hear who's playing his wife in my movie? You're playing his wife in my movie.
Uh-oh.
Here's my issue with Scott's film. Christians, Christians is a clusterfuck.
It has you in it.
Yes, it is.
You have a chance to steal the scenes here.
But I don't know how well that's going to play in the foreign territories, me and Hal.
I don't know, man.
You're huge overseas.
Yeah, you are.
and Scott's movie, by definition, it's not a buddy comedy. It's a romantic comedy.
But it's a buddy comedy that turns into a romantic comedy, but it stays at its heart.
But Nick's not a remake fan.
It's a romantic comedy, and plus, you are pitching something very dirty, very NC-17.
Yeah, but here's the thing.
Nick,
very dirty.
Guys, here's what you forget. Nick Mundy is not a remake fan, and you're going to remake one of his favorite movies and put him in that? He wants to do something original. That's
but
why I'm talking original.
It. Nick Mundy, don't remake. Forget. That's what
don't,
makes
don't
it good.
Don't forget that Nick Mundy is a good comedy writer. So you
may
give him
we,
my silly story
may we get
with
back,
Hal Rudnick.
Wait a minute.
May we get back to the best idea here?
Yeah, well, we're talking about it.
Die Hard 6, stop the making of Die Hard 6.
That's
it's a documentary. John Schnapp's done it.
No, nobody will get
it. Here's a sample scene from it. Nick and Reginald Vell Johnson arrive at the home of Alan Rickman.
With the Twinkies?
They ring the doorbell. Alan Rickman opens the door. Yes. Nick says, Mr. Gruber, Mr. Hans Gruber, will you help me make this? Will you help me stop the making of Die Hard 6? And he says, while I support your cause, I've learned that Bruce Willis is an unstoppable madman. I shan't be helping you. Good day. And Nick is like, Nick turns to Reginald Vell Johnson and says, I guess we gotta do it ourselves, Reg.
Okay, cool. Give me a quick scene.
Get a quick scene. On a train, in one of the cargo things, you know, where you just sort of hop on the train, they're doing a little campfire, and they're just like opening up to each other, and they realize the vulnerability that they each have, and they have more in common than not in common, and then they kiss and they make love.
So we on a train.
And
bang on a train.
That's dirty.
And your wife does. Place is as actually the person in okay. actually filming.
Calm down.
Real Margot Robbie.
Nope. Give me a scene, but 30 seconds.
You with a pair of nunchucks fighting a bunch of Blu-ray boxes of all the movies you hate. With sneakers and flying jump kicks and ninjas come out, and Hal Rudnick just goes, ninjas.
Okay.
Ninjas.
Okay, here's the thing.
Ninjas.
Ninjas.
Ninjas. Stop. Ninjas came out. What year?
You made my wife really uncomfortable.
Oh, jeez.
I'm into
You're
it.
You're uncomfortable, are you?
Hal won that one. Hal won. He had the real scene.
That was a real scene.
I shan't be.
How do you
Ninjas.
You should have done an Alan Rickman impression.
Yeah.
All right, round 5, last round. Guys.
It's over, isn't it?
No, one more.
For clarification, Hal is automatically in the speed round now.
Hal is in the speed round.
It's a fight between
the two. It's up to you guys, but hey, Hal can get the points. Guys, we're about to do the best movie fight question in the history of movie fights. I made it. There will never be a better question than this unless they rip it off. Fight 6. In 1991, there was a restaurant created. By three men. Yeah, 1991. Arnold Schwarzenegger, Sylvester Stallone, Bruce Willis. In celebration to that great piece of Americana, who would you rather bang, marry, kill? 1990s, Arnold Schwarzenegger, Sylvester Stallone, or Bruce Willis? Who would you rather bang, marry, or kill?
Oh, I forget what I'm supposed to choose.
Okay. Hal, you're up first. Quit. We got to do it quick.
Yep. I would kill Bruce Willis, I would bang Stallone, and I would marry Arnold. And here's why. Bruce Willis...
Guys, we are doing epitome... Like, we are making God's work with this movie fight question.
We know Bruce Willis checks out. He has checked out. Oh, let's just get rid of him. Stallone, like, I wouldn't want to be married to that guy because, like, when you're trying to have conversation around the breakfast table, he's like, give me my steroids. So I'd bang him and have it over with. Arnold, he makes me laugh. So that's what'll make a marriage go.
Scott, I'm going to have you go real quick.
I'm gonna marry Stallone. I'm going to bang Schwarzenegger, and I'm going to kill Willis. Willis is just arrogant. I just don't like this
guy.
Even
1990s Willis.
1990s, 80s, 90s, 2000s, whatever. Willis is arrogant. I just want to kill him now. Stallone has heart. He's someone who would be faithful to you. Schwarzenegger, not faithful, but the best looking of the bunch. That's why I would bang Schwarzenegger.
Okay, so the difference is you would marry Stallone and you would bang him.
Yes.
Okay.
We're talking about early 90s, right?
Yeah.
All right, then I'm killing Stallone because he made Rocky V.
that's interesting.
Yeah. As far as I like Rocky V. Now, I would marry Willis because at the time, in the 90s, he's going to take care of you. Took care of a lot. It took care of his kids. Took care of Demi Moore. Was making a lot of money. I'm in good shape. As far as I'll bang Arnold because if I can take it, then he was huge back then. If I can take Arnold back then, then good for me.
he said stop Stallone because he made Rocky V. Willis made Die Hard V.
Oof.
Die Hard V is the worst movie.
This year was just
we're talking about the 90s, early 90s.
This is at the height of their powers.
Yeah.
Oh, at the height of their powers.
Yeah.
Except for maybe Stallone. So okay. So you get. What do you guys think about Scott's? Like, what do you guys think of marrying Stallone, killing Schwarzenegger? No, killing. And then banging.
But being married to Stallone.
Stallone cheated on everybody. Like, yeah. That's the problem, is that he had too many. He was Bridget Nielsen. There's so many women.
Hey, Bridget.
He was at the height. You couldn't hold him down. Bruce Willis was committed to his lady for a long time.
Here's why you marry Schwarzenegger.
Come on.
Nick Mundy, I want to hold you and keep Count you safe Dracula. For the rest of your life. Nick, come with me if you want to live.
Not the best impression. Okay. No. Okay. I think this is how I'm going to figure it out, because we're going to focus on love. Right, Jason? We're going to focus on love.
Yeah, that's a good...
Why would you marry your gentleman fellow?
Well, I think I said it already. Because at the time, faithful guy, took care of his lady, took care of his kids. This is Bruce Willis. He was making a lot of money, and he was a family guy. I don't care what happened to him now, and if he phones it in, he still phones it in. You never hear about him being a bad dad, bad husband. So, and look, they got divorced.
Yeah, he had that wine cooler money, too.
Yeah. So, look, and he's a great singer. Sing you a lullaby when you go to
sleep. Okay, and then and why would you marry Mr. Stallone?
I would marry Mr. Stallone because he made one of my favorite movies of all time. He made Demolition Man. I love Demolition Man. I love Demolition Man.
Coming to play.
Man, Demolition Man is the best
and
movie
bring
about
tacos
the future.
In bed. Bring
it really
tacos.
Is. He eat tacos. But he also, I'm going to say, because I am from Philadelphia, I have a soft spot for Rocky V. Not the best of the bunch by far, but it still has a lot of heart to it. And the fact that he brought full closure to Rocky with Rocky V.
You're talking about the one with Tommy Gunn.
You mean Rocky VI. Yes. Rocky VI is the closure.
Rocky VI. Well, Rocky VI.
Rocky
was
five, Rocky
no, in the 90s.
Ninjas.
In the 90s. At the time, it was full
circle. Nick, get a load of this. I've saved you a space
on
my chopper. Get on the chopper.
How's that?
This is embarrassing. It sounds like Count Dracula. It doesn't sound like Arnold.
No, that's better. That's a better Arnold. Okay. Jason, how are the facts? Could you imagine Dan doing this and him crying?
Steam coming out of his ears.
I mean, I do think that Christian makes a valid point that 1990 Schwarzenegger would be a lot to take.
Yeah.
You know, that's factual.
Yeah,
that's factual.
Bragging rights.
Arnold would probably buy you a chopper. Yes.
Yeah, Hal's gone with the terrible impression. Here's the thing that I'm falling on this. The person who actually... I felt a lot of love from someone. I feel like Scott Mance really does love Sylvester Stallone. And Christian, I'm sorry you're out, but yeah. Stallone is getting... like.
I love him.
Yeah, Scott got... I feel that love.
I'm happy
I
with
love
my
Stallone.
Answer.
Guys, wow. And this was... the greatest movie fight debate
ever.
Question.
Ever. Yes.
We did it. There's your thumbnail, Jason.
Come with me if you want to get married.
All right, guys. So we are heading into speed round.
Scott and Hal.
Whoa.
Play that music. I got to read some rules.
Oh, my God.
Thanks, guys.
Speed
who can contain this? Listen, you stay, because I'm going to need your help. Delar, I'm going to need your help.
Mance.
Guys, Christian, this was your best movie fight, and I appreciate you more than anything. Guys. Speed round rules. Speed round. This is your chance for five more points to win the game.
Mm-hmm.
The panelist with the lowest points is automatically out. Christian, you're out. I don't know why I have to reiterate that.
Come on.
I will ask the question. We're looking for fast, quick answers with short follow-ups. On either question, if two players chooses the same answer, the player who said it first gets to argue that answer. The other player has to argue for a different answer. Yes.
So do I say the answer or I say like my name and then
the answer? You say the answer. You don't yell Scott Mance because I will disqualify you. Hey guys, I want to just mention that Christian Harloff did not mention like the extended universe, and I'm really happy about that. So I think that was very
Is that why it was my best fight?
Yes. Yeah, okay. Okay, so the player who answers the first gets 15 answers, and the second player gets another 15 seconds to rebuttal, and that's not the word, and then the first player gets a 5-second rebuttal to make it fair. So, questions? Any questions?
So, if he says the answer, I get a rebuttal.
No. If he goes first, you get to rebuttal, and then he has a 5-second rebuttal.
Got it. Okay.
You have 15 seconds.
To what you said.
Are we sponsored by Taco Bell yet?
We are not sponsored by Taco Bell yet, but we might be sponsored by Bruce Willis's wine coolers. Hopefully we get that done.
Seagram's.
All right, guys. All right. Let's do some speed rounds. Speed round, guys, I will tell you this right now. I wrote most of these questions.
Okay.
So one, except I didn't write this one. This is from Fred Jones at Fred_Jones. If you had to replace Pauly Shore with Rutger Hauer in a Pauly Shore movie, what Pauly Shore movie would you remake?
By a Son-in-Law.
Okay, I heard Biodome first.
And Son-in-Law.
Son-in-Law. This is going to be the best speed round ever. Go.
Biodome is kind of a sci-fi movie, and Rutger Hauer was in one of the greatest sci-fi movie of all time, Blade Runner. He is perfect for Biodome, and they also sang the song, Iron Man does whatever an iron can. So there you go.
Okay.
How cool would it be for that woman to bring home to her family grizzled Rutger Hauer as the son-in-law? And the hitcher, he's on the farm, and he's going to take them out one at a time.
Your Rutger Hauer is so much better than your Arnold Schwarzenegger. 5 seconds.
Okay, Rutger Hauer, you're combining science fiction and comedy, and this Biodome is like Pauly Shore's best movie.
All right, I'm in the little middle. Jason, what do you think?
Oh, it's Dolores.
Dolores.
Oh, God.
Oh, God, I'm still here.
We'll go with Hal's argument.
Hal's? And then Jason?
I think the science fiction aspect is a good argument.
That was me. Yeah, you had me on the science fiction. I think that would be really, really super creepy. All right. Scott won. All right. The best speed round ever. All right, so are we tied? 3-3?
We are tied. 3-3.
Right. Okay, Christian, what do you think?
Well, it doesn't matter now.
No. All right. Okay, guys, second question. What is the best Burt Reynolds performance?
Boogie Nights.
Smokey and the Bandit.
Go.
Boogie Nights is the best performance. It's the best acting on his behalf. He kills that movie. As the colonel running the porn industry, you believe that character. It's not his most fun, but it is his best.
Smokey and the Bandit is his most iconic role. That is the movie that people think about when they think of Burt Reynolds. It played into his sex appeal, and it also was a great performance, and he had great chemistry with Sally Field.
He had a number of great performances in that era. This movie, Boogie Nights, tricked everyone into thinking he was having a comeback.
That was mean. That was unnecessary.
It was that good.
Dilara, what'd you think? Good.
Scott?
Scott?
You should ask Kristen's opinion.
Christian.
I got a howl on that one.
Oh, God damn it. This sucks because it's not my favorite movie, but this is movie fights and blah, 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 blah. I got to go with Hal. Smokey the Bandit is way better than Boogie Nights. I will just go on the record. Hands down, 100%, but the performance. All right.
That's right.
Hal takes the lead.
Hal takes the lead. Okay. All three of these are on cable. Which do you watch? Rookie of the Year, Little Big League, Angels in the Outfield.
Rookie of the Year.
Hold on. Calm down, baby.
Rookie.
Little Big League.
Ooh.
Okay, Thomas Ian Nicholas, is that the guy who was in Rookie of the Year?
Yes.
That is a fairy tale. That is a perfect movie. It's a movie for kids. It is a movie for grown-ups. It is an American film. It has a big heart. It's fun. It's just a wonderful, wonderful film. Underrated little scene film. There you go.
This is the most personal question of the entire round, of the entire fights. Little Big League, he plays for the Minnesota Twins. I am a Minnesota Twins fan. Look at my credit card. Do not show the number.
Don't show the number.
Minnesota Twins. It's Little Big League.
5 seconds.
Okay, well, again, that's great to have a personal affiliation to Little Big League, but for people, for in general, this is a fairy tale.
Passion!
I gotta go with Scott. Yeah. I hate that because I like Little Big League more. I gotta go with Scott.
All right.
What's it? Is it tied still?
It is now back to tied.
God.
4-4.
We're gonna be here forever.
All right.
All right, guys. What's the best movie with show in the title?
Truman Show.
Oh, Show.
Show. Oh, okay.
I thought you said Joe. I'm sorry.
Show.
Show.
Should we?
Five. Quiz Show.
Quiz Show, okay.
Best in Show.
Rocky Horror Picture Show.
Best in Show.
Okay, Hal, go. Show.
Truman Show is the best performance of Jim Carrey's career, him trying to actually do some acting. And it's really scarily relevant today with the type of reality shows we see and Nothing is Sacred.
Quiz Show, directed by Robert Redford, was nominated for Best Picture and Best Director. It is a study in ethics. It is also a play on reality TV of the 50s, which were the quiz shows, which were rigged. It holds up. It is just as timely then as it is now.
Truman Show takes us on a journey, and it's such a compelling character. Jim Carrey actually made us feel in that movie, one of the rare times.
Christian, what do you think?
Gotta go Mance. Mance had a lot of great facts to back up that point.
This is tough. This is real tough. Delar?
Oh, boy. I don't know. I'm kind of tired.
Jason?
Mance bringing in Oscar wins the argument for me.
Yeah, Mance had that. God, man, that was good. That was really good. Mance. All right. We have one. Okay. Now, if Mance wins this, it's 5-4, right?
If Mance wins the next question, Mance wins the game. If Hal wins it, we go to a tiebreaker.
Okay. In honor of the Martian trailer directed by Ridley Scott, what is the best Tony Scott movie?
True Romance.
Crimson Tide.
Crimson Tide, True Romance.
Okay. True Romance.
Wow.
No One Picked Days of Thunder, which I feel is a
Man fun. On Fire.
Okay, Hal, go.
True Romance is one of the great action crime films. Man, so many great performances. Christopher Walken and Dennis Hopper, that scene. Oh, Gary Oldman. That film is chocked, Phil. You're not going to beat True Romance. Such an awesome Tarantino script.
You are going to beat True Romance with Crimson Tide. Gene Hackman and Denzel Washington, two Oscar winners going head-to-head in a post-Cold War thriller about a submarine, another study in ethics. This is a battle of wits. It is intense. It is gripping. It is exciting.
All right. I'm both giving you, under my rules, another 10 seconds. You guys more or less just said poster words. Give me something more for that movie.
True Romance is a great crime film. It's a compelling love story. That's a good movie. True Romance is going to grab you. The bloody action, the great writing, it's funny.
The fate of the entire world is in the hands of this submarine that cannot be in touch with the outside world. And it becomes a battle between Gene Hackman and Denzel Washington. Are they going to fire the missiles or are they going to hold the peace?
True Romance, you have so many awesome... Can I keep going?
No.
Okay.
That's it.
Okay.
That's it.
We're going tiebreaker. Hal won that one. All right.
Jesus.
I said.
You can use either tiebreaker.
Yeah, I'm using the second tiebreaker.
Okay.
Guys. And this is poetic.
Is this for the winner?
Yes. Okay.
For the winner.
Thank you. Who would win in a fight to the death, which we're doing at not at all? John Rambo or John Matrix from The Commando?
Rambo.
John Rambo.
Man's got Rambo.
Okay.
Rambo. I mean, he's Rambo. He took on an entire army in First Blood 2. I mean, he took on the Iraqi army in Rambo 3. This guy is a one-man army. There's no stopping this guy.
John Matrix would win because you know what drove him? His daughter. He had to get his daughter back. That your guy, he lived for nothing. We're saying who would live. okay? Who would live? Matrix would survive because he has a daughter to raise. Rambo would die for it.
Rambo, he fought for the entire country, and he fought for himself.
He fought for America. He fought for himself.
God, that was incredible. That was incredible. Oh, man. All right, that's it. But I'm gonna just pull it.
An army too.
Christian, what do you think?
He was talking about going after his daughter. He wasn't talking about a fight. He was talking about a fight. The question was who would win in a fight, right?
Yep.
I give it to Chris. You weren't talking about Dillard. Fights.
Scott.
Hal, you're my good friend. Scott came.
Scott's the winner.
That was so close.
That's his first win.
That was so close.
Thank you, guys.
That was so close.
That was the greatest to the death fight we've ever had.
Oh, I know. I was waiting for Hal to say Matrix fought an army, too.
That was so. Wait. Oh, I feel weird.
Well done.
Guys.
Matrix.
Guys, that was.
My son.
Can I say money that John Matrix might win that fight?
Well, we'll see. But, man, that is.
Whoa,
guys! Whoa. We didn't have a train wreck of a show. A
cocaine donkey.
Yeah,
we did not have a train wreck of a show. Like, that's amazing. We're now out of time. What did you guys think? Put comments and stuff.
Monty Fights is the best, baby.
You still yelling about Star
close.
Trek?
That was this close.
Oh man!
I still should have won that Star Trek question, but I'm okay.
Shut up!
I'm okay.
You won the shut up! I will take that point back. Yeah. Guys,
Joseph Gordon-Levitt just lost to Bruce Willis.
Yeah. Guys, if you're watching on YouTube, oh man, that was tough. Guys, if you're watching on YouTube, post some comments. Maybe tell me how great or terrible of a job I did.
Post good comments, please.
And more importantly, tell us what you thought of the fight and, you know, what questions you want. And if you're on iTunes, subscribe and rate and all that jive. T-shirts. We talked about T-shirts. District Lines. Go get a Hal Rednick T-shirt. Ask for a Monday T-shirt. Wait, go get a...
Can I say one thing about my show on YouTube?
We're not there yet.
Okay. We'll get there.
I will disqualify you and give it to Hal. You don't
no
shut up.
Plugs. No quick plugs.
Yeah.
Go to districtlines.com for district.lines.com/screenjunkies. You'll get a shirt like Jason has. You'll get some Honest Trailer shirts. It's a lot of fun. Guys, I want to thank the panelists. I want to thank Christian, who did the best movie fights ever. Always be like that.
Have you watched the last two times I've been on the show?
I was with
you. On it.
I was with you.
I made up a movie. I made up a movie and almost won.
Okay. You're at Christian Harloff. Follow him. Subscribe to Schmoes.
Yeah, please check out Schmoes. And thanks to Jason. Those guys are putting the link for Schmoes on the bottom here. So make sure you go and subscribe. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Scott?
Okay. Well, yes, of course, I'm on Access Hollywood. But what I really need help with is please check out Profiles with Malone and Mance. Yes, this is Alicia Malone. It's my co-host and co-producer on Profiles. Go to our Facebook page, which is Profiles with Malone and Mance. Like our page. Please check out our show on YouTube and on iTunes.
Guys, if you think I'm lowbrow and garbage, Scott and Alicia are the opposite. They know what they're talking about. They're really smart. Check it out. It's great. Hal Rednick, my sweet boy.
Oh, I'm so sorry. I feel guilty.
It was fair and square, and you're a good man. You're a good man. Oh. Scott won it. Fair and square.
That
Christian,
was so close.
Seeing you.
I was here. Thanks for showing up.
Please follow me on Twitter at Hal Rudnick and check out the Screen Junkie show every Thursday.
Perfect. And then on the wife cam, we have my wife, Delara.
Yay, Delara.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Delara. This was so much fun.
I think your Mulan answer was stupid.
What? You're stupid.
Oh! You locked out of your house.
I agree
shots
with Mulan.
Fired.
No. Props
to Jason for being back.
Jason, thanks so much.
I also have a podcast called Geek History Lesson, and September 14th, I have a Star Trek web series, The Red Shirt Diaries, which stars three of the guys at the table up there.
Yes, Trelane. Trelane is in the house, please.
And guys, I'm Nick Mundy. You can follow me at Dick Fundy. I don't have anything going on.
Follow me.
I got my second wedding coming up. I'm not going to promote that.
Oh, yeah. Follow me on Twitter at Movie Mance. Yes. Movie Mance. Thank you.
But thank you guys for watching. Please come back. Andy will be back. Things will get back to normal or
or not.
Yeah. And we'll have some fun. Let's have some fun. Bring a beer.
Give it up for Nick Mundy.
Mundy Fights. Peace out.
Every podcast we put on YouTube comes with this kick-ass graphic listing all the topics your favorite Screen Junkies podcasters are talking about. If you click the topics, you can skip around and choose your own podcast battle royale. Go ahead, try them all. If you haven't already, subscribe to Screen Junkies on YouTube to join us for future fights. Or if you prefer to listen on iTunes, click the logo to download an audio version.